John Senior, how did you get from being the king of business valuation, the proponent, the progressive, the pioneer in BV, to now a cage rattler in cannabis?
Well, I appreciate those words, Rick. I feel like I was a bit of a pioneer in business valuation, and it was fortuitous. I just happened to be in the right place at the right time, volunteering for AICPA. I was on their consulting services division on their executive committee back when people started to say, this valuation stuff seems to be getting hot. We ought to develop some content. And Gary Trugman, who's an old friend of mine, one of the founders as well, a mentor of mine, Larry Cook, who was also a mentor, we were on the consulting services executive committee when we said, let's go find some BV content. And we worked with AICPA to license some content from the state of Illinois that had a program at the time. And then we decided that content was deficient, so we had to rewrite it. I got very involved in rewriting it and then teaching it, and have been involved in what's now the forensic evaluation section of the AICPA since then, and it's been a great ride. I've got to meet a lot of amazing people along the way and learn a lot of things. So and I'm based in Denver, Colorado, but I grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan in the 60s and 70s. I graduated from high school in 1971 in May. In June of 1971, a guy by the name of John Sinclair got arrested for smoking two joints on the University of Michigan Diag and sentenced to 10 years in prison for possessing two marijuana joints. That was a month after I graduated from high school. John Lennon came to Ann Arbor when the Beatles were touring America in 71 and did a free John Sinclair benefit concert in Ann Arbor. And a month later, the Michigan Supreme Court commuted John Sinclair's sentence to time served. So that was kind of where marijuana first kind of got in my head. And growing up in Ann Arbor, then moving to Colorado and being at the forefront of the industry in terms of the regulated legal side of the market, has created opportunities for me. I have a good friend, a golf buddy that belongs to my country club, that called me one day. We've been doing his taxes for 20 years, and he said, "Ron, my neighbor wants me to buy into a dispensary." This was 2009. Would you help keep me out of trouble if I do that? And the first thing I needed to do was talk to my two partners, call Mary Medley, the CEO of the Colorado Society of CPAs, and say, "Is this something we should do?" Because back then, the specter of aiding and abetting under the Controlled Substances Act was a lot more relevant than it is today. It's still there and it's still hanging out there. But I helped my friend get into the cannabis business. He developed where he had five dispensaries and two grow operations, and since that time, we've evolved where we do some tax compliance work. We're pretty selective on who we accept. And we've done a lot of appraisal work in cannabis and hemp and CBD. And it's been just fascinating for me because I've been doing valuation, as I said, since kind of when it first became on the radar of AICPA back late 1980s. And now I'm 66 years old and I'm kind of finishing my career. I feel like I still got a few good years left, and I'm spending a fair amount of it in this sector. And it's fascinating to me because it's, as I said in the speech I just gave, it's kind of a cross between legalized gambling and the repeal of prohibition, although it's happening in baby steps. But because of that, it creates so many nuances and challenges in terms of how do you do risk analysis for a cannabis business because it's illegal at the federal level. The technology and the innovation is changing so dramatically. It's just incredible to watch what's happening in the industry, from how you grow it, how you process it, how you sell it, just everything involved in it. It's just incredible to watch the winners and the losers. The big boys are coming, big boys and gals that are being strategic, looking at location and looking at bifurcating into certain sectors. I'm going to be the best cultivator, I'm going to be the best processor, I'm going to be the best retailer, or being vertically integrated and saying we're going to be big and we're going to be from what we call seed to sale. We're going to plant it, grow it, process it, and sell it. And it's just amazing watching how different clients and operators are performing and rising to those challenges, especially in emerging markets. Colorado is fairly stable. It's still evolving, quickly, but you know, we're doing work in Virginia and Massachusetts and Michigan. Illinois, it just looks like they're about ready to go recreational or adult use. That's a big market, you know, and at some point there's going to be a watershed moment when the government, the federal government, says, you know, the horse has left the barn, we need to change this at the federal level. It's going to make dramatic changes. The advent of interstate commerce, when growers and processors in California can come to Nevada, or the people in Colorado can go to Nebraska, it's just going to be so dynamic. So it's kind of interesting to kind of have our feet in the water, so to speak, in an industry that is, it's fun. It really is. We've written a book called and I have a copy of it right here, if you don't mind me putting it up, the Cannabis Industry Accounting and Appraisal Guide that we published in July of last year. I wrote it with my partner Brenda Clark and a colleague Stacy Udell out of New Jersey, and it's been a door opener for us. It's 220 pages of resources for if you're working with clients in the business on 280E, bookkeeping, charts of accounts, risk assessment. There's a sample valuation report, a very extensive bibliography, case law summaries of the landmark cases in the industry that are just fascinating to read in terms of testing for, you know, employers' rights, banking issues, you know, what you can deduct, what you can't deduct. The case law is just continuing to evolve, and that's kind of interesting to kind of keep your eye on as well. So yeah, it's just been a great ride for us, and it's fun doing it.
Is it a good place for a local firm? Because the industry is consolidating very quickly. The client side of the industry is consolidating very quickly, and we've got top 100 firms who are moving in very quickly into this business. What's the future of the local firm in this business?
That's a great question, Rick. The big firms are moving in, particularly in the attestation and assurance side, because some of the states like Michigan and Arizona require at least annual audited financials. So Crow, Cohen Resnick have really gotten into it big time. A lot of the other firms have kind of stayed on the sidelines, I think, because they're trying to figure out this, you know, federal illegality and should they be in it, should they not. I think that's the big firms are coming because they realize it's destined to be a $20-30 billion industry in the next year or two, and that's a lot of business. If right now the small firms have, it's been good because a lot of the competition stayed on the sidelines, which has created opportunity for small firms. There's a lot of small local practitioners that don't have those attestation requirements that just need help with tax compliance. Help us figure out 280E. Help us figure out how to maximize our tax deductions in an industry that's in the highest tax bracket of anything I've ever seen. So local practitioners, there's a huge opportunity. On the appraisal side, an enormous opportunity. There aren't many people that know what we know. There's a couple of colleagues, one that's out of Southern California. She and I talk regularly. We've had cases where maybe I'm conflicted out, and the attorney or even the court will say, can you recommend 3 qualified appraisers for this cannabis dispute we have in Oregon or wherever it might be? And between my colleague in California and I and Stacy in New Jersey, it's like we have a hard time coming up with 3 or 4 qualified people. So there's a huge opportunity for small firms that do appraisal work or litigation work or tax compliance work. And even at attestation, there's cash management issues. There's lots of issues in this industry that require, you know, good, competent CPAs and professionals to help them.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.